Okay, good evening, everybody. Welcome to a slightly delayed beginning of our final program of the 2018-2019 New York ARSC chapter meeting season. Tonight is going to prove to be a very interesting one, and we have two very exciting... Gesundheit.
Thank you.
That's a way to introduce yourself. Two very interesting presenters, both who are not new to presenting here at ARSC. What I'd like to do is introduce each one of them and let them give you a slight biography of themselves instead of me sitting here babbling on along about two pages worth. So let me first introduce Jeffrey Swann. Jeffrey.
Okay.
Good evening.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm basically a concert pianist, and since we're talking about competitions, I entered not a huge number, but five or six big international competitions, and my career and my life was very much shaped one way or the other by them. I was born in Arizona and grew up in Texas and went to Juilliard when I was 17 and have lived in New York ever since. And I currently also teach at NYU for, I guess, the last 10, 12 years. And that's the thumbnail description of my life.
Okay. And the other person next to him is Joe Patrych. Joe, tell us something about yourself.
I hate when people ask me these questions. I'm a recording producer, born and bred in New York. That's all you need to know.
Okay. He's also responsible for supervising and doing the video recordings we do that then get posted on
Except
the website.
Except today.
But you're still the
My trusty associate is handling it for me.
Right, but even then, it's because of Joe that this has become very successful. That originally ARSC, the main board, only wanted to fund, three or four for a year, I think, at one point? And then all of a sudden they started seeing the hits when it went up on YouTube, and they decided, we'll fund you for the entire year, meaning 10 programs a year, which is part of the entire season. In fact, one of them, the first one Don Manildi did, I think had over 4,000 hits. He was even taken aback by that. He had done it on encores. A famous pianist, and they're on the encores that were so important as part of the programming in the golden age of pianism. Well, anyway, I'm going to turn this over to you now, and you gentlemen can explain what you're doing this evening.
If we can figure it out.
Okay. What we're
well, I figured it out.
It's well, Bartok, as everybody knows, made a comment once that competitions are for racehorses. This has not in any way deterred the prestidigital among us to enter as many as possible, and the proliferation of competitions has increased over the years from the earlier days when there were relatively few. Now they're all over the place. The question is, are they still important in the development of a career? And so what Jeff and I want to discuss today is what the trajectory of competitions has been. We're going to talk about some of the controversies, some of the things that have happened from the early days. We're going to concentrate on the big ones. There's five competitions that are generally considered to be at the top of the pile. And they are the Leeds, the Tchaikovsky, the Cliburn, Warsaw Chopin, and Queen Elizabeth. Those are the ones that have probably generated the most piano careers. Although, of course, there have been ones coming out of some other competitions as well. Having said that, sometimes the winner is not the winner. And we'll talk about that a little bit, too. So at this point, I would like to bring Jeff into our discussion here.
Well, there's so much to talk about. The big, I think, difficulty is to sort of try to get some order into it. I think that, let me just put a little tiny bit of history, that music competitions, for the purpose of titillation of the audience and of sort of creating the excitement of rivalries and things, goes way back. I guess you'd have to call the Liszt duels with Thalberg as a kind of competition. And there were the odd competitions in the late 18th century and turn of the century. But competitions as we know them, the music competitions, I think really started after the First World War and in the establishment. The Chopin competition in Warsaw is one of the oldest. The Queen Elizabeth, which was always violin and piano alternating, is also almost as old. They both start in the interwar years.
Yeah.
All the other ones we're talking about are more recent. Before we go into all the pros and cons of the way that the role of the competitions and how it's changed, which it indubitably has, especially I would say since about 1980, I think that I'm going to play a little bit, not devil's advocate, but just from another point of view, and talk about one of the reasons why I think competitions have proliferated and continue to proliferate, not necessarily for their own good, but still a reason, which is that competitions can, if organized well, create a lot of local excitement. That's a whole aspect of competitions that sometimes get overlooked. We sometimes typically think of the competition in terms of its success in terms of strictly who won and how well did the winner do, or who or how well the winners did. But sometimes the real excitement and value of the competition is simply that it radically transforms the life of a city for a few days or a few weeks, and people get really involved in the competition, get involved with the contestants. Now, whether this is a healthy thing or a good thing could be argued, but it's certainly an indisputable thing.
But does it carry over after the competition?
Well, that of course, is a question. I guess the most extreme example of this, and I've lived it, is because it was my very first competition, my first trip to Europe, my first actual sort of initiation into international music world, was the Warsaw competition. In Warsaw, now it's true, this was 1970, in communist Europe, there was very little to do. Classical music was cheap and available. There were no movies to go see, so people flocked to concerts. But it's worth noticing that here, and very often competitions, the early rounds especially, the contestants play to completely empty houses. In Warsaw, not only was the Warsaw Philharmonic Hall, the National Theater, sold out for all rounds and still is today, but that all the contestants, including the ones in the first round, and there were like 135 or something, which brings up a whole other issue we have to talk about. You know, the
attrition.
No, I'm preliminaries of how the pros and cons of how that works. The point there being is that in the old days, competitions basically took everybody who applied with, if they had a halfway decent CV and recommendations and things like that. Also because it was a way of making money since there's entry fees. But anyway, in Warsaw, everybody who played had to go play again in this like circus arena, where there'd be like 8,000 people, because these are the people who couldn't get tickets to hear the competition. And it's on the live radio all the time, every day, every day. And this competition is three sessions a day for a month, the whole month of October. So, you know, this is, but, you know, Chopin is sort of the national hero. There's a lot of other factors. But that's an extreme example. But sometimes in little towns, there can be a lot of excitement.
Well, Fort Worth is
Fort Worth.
Cliburn, because I was there in 89 and you were there.
I was there too.
In 77. During the Cliburn, yeah. Fort Worth becomes piano crazy.
Sure. Well, Fort Worth is my mother's hometown. My mother was born and grew up in Fort Worth, and she was the president of the Tarrant County Piano Teachers Association when I was unfortunately in that competition. I won third prize, which isn't so bad, but it was bad for me at the time, and I didn't want to be there. Nobody wants to do a competition in his or her hometown. That's a lot of extra pressure, especially in that case. We can talk about that when we get there. Since I touched on the story, you might as well, one thing I'd like to cover right now before we listen to anything, and this is the whole very double-edged aspect of how competitions can control the sheer numbers. What are the problems involved with that? There are so many pianists now, and even though so many violinists now, and even though there are also so many competitions, almost every competition gets an extraordinarily large number of applicants. Sometimes hundreds, and the really big ones, like Moscow or something, literally hundreds. So what can they do? If you allow all of them in, then you have the problem, one, you have to pay a jury a lot of money. You pay the jury by the day, you have to pay their hotels and meals, and the jury is worn out. The jury gets completely exhausted. And the jury has and I've been on juries with Queen Elizabeth twice, before they had any kind of elimination round. So we had to go from, by rules, from something like 145 to 24 in one fell swoop. So, you know, that's, you get this grand massacre and all sorts of terrible things happen, and the way you listen to music is by force changed to some extent. So competitions try to find ways to avoid that. And the main way, most competitions avoid that today, probably all but just a few, by having contestants send in DVDs. Now, they used to have them send in CDs, but too many contestants cheated and would send in, like, Horowitz a CD and say it's theirs, or Rubinstein, or
edit it.
Or edit it.
That was the other thing. They would edit it because editing became cheap and available. And so, finally, it became...
A joke.
Yeah, so, I mean, you could sound like Richter and then come and sound like Richter's dog.
Yeah, and this happened all the time. I mean, in my experience, it happened on juries. So the other people would say, gosh, he sounded so good on his CD. And I said, well, yeah, but it wasn't him. So now it's DVDs. So then you have a whole other, how are they listened to, under what conditions? Is it really serious listening? Is it fair? In other words, are all people being listened to really the same? Because it's very seldom in a controlled environment. Or the very few competitions, like the Cliburn or the Paderewski, which is one we're not talking about in Poland, which have sectionals, and they pay for a small jury to travel around the world and hear people, and then the contestants for the big competition are selected from these sectional competitions. Of course, this first thing is an extremely expensive undertaking, but then it also opens up a whole other can of worms. It's much fairer in terms of the listing conditions, but it's not the same jury as the big competition.
Well, that's the thing that isn't fair.
Well, that
and you really have to send the same jury around to every venue.
Yeah. And it's become
listen, otherwise you don't have any consensus whatsoever, and it becomes rather meaningless.
Yeah, and it's prohibitively expensive to have a large, usually it's rather small panel. And just one other thing, since we're talking about this, and then I'm going to let Joe sort of direct this, listen to music and talk about more specific things, is the problem of juries, too. I think one of the things that people ask all the time is, you know, why traditionally juries consisted, not in the really old days, but in my day, mostly of teachers, very often the same teachers going to competition after competition. We call them the International Piano Mafia, the certain group of five or ten people.
Name shall not be mentioned, but any informed person can tell you who these people are.
I can just point out, for instance, I was on the jury of one of the very second-tier competitions, but still right at the top because it's old, the Busoni competition. I was on the jury, and it was just before Leeds, Warsaw, and Hamamatsu, which is a very big competition in Japan. And five of my colleagues out of 11 on the jury were doing all three of those after mine. So they're just.
That must have been 2009.
We won't go into detail. But anyway, it was one after the other after the other. And so you get the same group of people. So you start wondering, then why don't they get more performers? Why aren't the great performers on juries? Why are all these same teachers? But the problem is really simple there. I mean, we can talk about moral issues and the fact that the performers sometimes don't, even the ones who've won competitions, don't want to dirty their hands with dealing with it now. But the real issue is money. Because if I commit to judge, let's take the biggest example, probably the longest competition in today's world, they're not as long as they used to be because there's no longer these elimination rounds, but it would be Warsaw or Brussels. Those are still basically...
I would say Brussels.
About a month, okay. Yeah. So I'm going to commit a whole month to doing this. And as competition goes, it pays pretty well. But it pays about as much as one decent concert. So for me, so imagine if you're talking about Maurizio Pollini or Martha Argerich. Martha does do competitions sometimes because she doesn't like to play. But in other words, it's economically well nigh impossible to attract the great majority of soloists, of really active concert careers. So whereas teachers don't lose anything. On the contrary, they're paid bonuses. In many cases, a teacher is paid a bonus because the competition is viewed as a recruiting tool for them to go. So that's one of the reasons why you get those kinds of juries.
You know, apropos to this issue of attrition and trying to cut down a field of people, I think the 2015 Chopin was one of the most difficult ones, and also negative payback to the jury, who had to listen to 80 people, then the next round was cut down to 40 people, and the next round was cut down to 20 people, and then the finals. And I can't imagine being on a jury like that and having to listen to 80 people play Chopin ballades and try to figure out which 40 of them should go into the next round.
Well,
and the funny part was that most of the jury were previous winners. I think Garrick was on the jury, Argerich was on the jury, Adam Harshievitz, who won in 1955, was chairman, actually.
Oh, I think so, too.
At the age of 82, and a few other people of the winner's pool. And they all had to sit there and listen to 80 people play the same five pieces.
But at least these are substantial masterpieces. In Queen Elizabeth, one of the things that's very much discussed about competitions is it better to allow the contestants to choose freely, or is it better to have a very rigorously controlled repertoire? And the advantage of a controlled repertoire is how can you compare Mozart with Rachmaninoff? The advantage the idea is they all play the same thing, so you can judge them on the same criteria. But then you get the following. So the Queen Elizabeth has always had a couple of pieces that every contestant has to play, one in the first round, one in the second round. And in both cases, the contestants are all told what the piece is, like 1 month before the competition. So I had to listen to 135 performances, 135 of Mozart's variations on Salve Tu Domine, which is a pleasant enough sort of minor piece. But how can you judge 135 performances of a piece like that? I mean, what ends up happening, of course, is that you don't. You just simply listen to it sort of in a stupor, and if somebody makes some really terrible, egregious mistake, you say, okay, they're out. Otherwise, so you are forced into, to me, the ultimate sort of existential difficulty of being on a jury, which is trying to prize and value and reward good playing, good music making, rather than penalize bad music making.
Okay, so let's delve into this a little. So you have 135 people playing the same piece by Mozart.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you can eliminate a third of them for making a boo-boo somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do about the other 90?
I don't use the Mozart as the criteria to decide who makes the next round. I'm sorry to say, but that's what ended up happening.
So you end up completely eliminating it from consideration.
That's exactly. The piece, basically, and talking to other jurors.
Thereby rendering it a complete waste of time.
A complete waste of time, from all standpoints. At least in the case of the Belgian piece, the modern piece, which there's every competition very often has, at least you could say, well, it's given some composer their moment of glory. But once again, you end up eliminating it unless...
This is a solo piece in one of the earlier rounds.
Yeah, and then you have to play the concerto.
The concerto is only the finalist.
Yes, the concerto is only the finalist. The solo piece is the second round.
I happen, by the way, to think that makes the Queen Elizabeth the most difficult competition to win, simply because you are given a brand new piano concerto if you make the finals and have 10 days to learn it.
Eight days. You go in. So here's after they announce the finalists... There's 1 day of rest for everybody. And then on the next day after, there's 12 finalists. The first two finalists go into what's called the Chapelle, which is just a music school, sort of in a rural setting, very beautiful place. And they take away in our day, we didn't have to deal with that. In our day, they didn't let us watch television, listen to the radio, or read newspapers. There's the telephone. Now they take away your computer, your cell phone, everything. You're supposed to have no contact with the outside world. And as you arrive, you are given this new concerto, which in my year was a 35-minute piece, that you have to play with the orchestra along with the concerto that you've brought to the competition, plus one other work from your program, which you have not done. So you have 8 days to learn. And each competitor has 8 days. So it means the first two... two a day go in for 6 days, and there's like 3 days when all 12 are there, and then sort of like in the dialogue of the Carmelites, two by two, they're all going off to be executed. I remember that very well because I was on the next to the last day. But on the advantage of being on the next to the last days, Emmanuel Ax was in my year. He was on the first day. So he had already had the piece for 5 days when I arrived. So the very first thing I did was I went to Emmanuel's room and said, please play me the piece. So, and he was happy to have a chance to play it so I could correct all of his misreadings, and I was happy to get an idea of what the hell it sounded like. So it was sort of a mutual, because you're not allowed to have any contact with anybody in the outside world, but you can have contact with the other contestants. By the way, this also is hard because people go crazy. The level of sheer, how many people today still see that movie, The Competition, with Amy Irving and Dreyfus.
Richard Dreyfus.
Yeah. And I remember people laughing and saying how crazy it is, and some things about it are utterly insane. But the sheer lunacy of the contestants under pressure is by no means insane. People do really crazy things.
That was the Ledouche.
That's right. Exactly good for you, Jacques Ledouche. The Queen Elizabeth competition, this is finishing the idea about judging things. I had a really interesting chance. You're not allowed to speak to other members of the jury. They're really strict about that. One time in the men's room, in the middle of the afternoon session, John Browning, who was also on the jury with me, and we're standing at the urinals, actually, and he says, "It's getting pretty hot this afternoon," because we'd had three or four really good ones. And there was one of the people from the administration of the competition who was washing his hands who said, "Mr. Browning, comments like that could get you eliminated from the jury." So you're not allowed to eat together with other members of the jury or stay in the same hotel, only when there's observers around. So they're very, very, that's of course overreaction, because in the earlier days of the competition, the Soviets just basically told everybody what to do, and that was that.
Including who to vote for.
Oh, totally. But this is by this time I was there in like '89, so I was there twice as on the jury. But one time, a pianist broke a hammer. And they decided that since we were short of time, that we would not leave the hall and go to the jury room. So we all sat in front of the whole jury on this big table in the front of the hall. And the hall's full of people, semifinals it must have been. And I was sitting next to this lovely gentleman, elderly man, Belgian man, who always came with the scores and had extremely elaborate, beautifully, he had rulers and things. He had graphs. He made these very involved graphs and was always writing things. And I just couldn't resist. I said, "I'm so impressed by all your, we're sitting there, who's going to stop us from talking?" So I said, "How impressive." He says, "Yes, over the years I've worked out the system of deductions. So I deduct, one point for a slipped note, and 1.5 points for pedal errors, and 3 points for stylistic mistakes, and 5 points for a minor memory lapse, and et cetera." He had it all worked out. It wasn't quite this, but it was just like that. And I'm listening with my eyes bigger and bigger. And finally I say, "Gosh, I have just the opposite approach." So in his approach, the pianist comes on stage. When they haven't played a note, they're 100%. And he deducts. And finally, so the person who hasn't played a note is doing the best, of course. So you wonder why bland people win. So I said, "Gosh, my approach is just the opposite." I said, "For me, everybody's a zero. And I add as they do good things." And he looks at me and he says, "That's very difficult." So there you go. And the point of this comment, which is something that we're going to come to over and over again, is that obviously I believe that you can get very lamentable results from this way of judging. But at the same time, in this case, the lamentable results were not because of collusion or dishonesty or politics or even bad musician. This man may be a wonderful musician, but it's a negative side to the system that brought this about.
But I think I think it's intelligent to have a system, because you can't go in there and just decide, "Okay, I'm just going to start listening and try to remember all the impressions," because 25 competitors in, you won't remember anything about the first one.
I personally write copiously. And people wonder, "Why are you writing such notes? Are anybody going to see them?" And the answer is, so I can remember.
Right.
And afterwards, contestants come up to you and say, "Professor Swann, how did I play, or why didn't I make it? What can you tell me? Can you advise me?" And I never have a clue until I look at my notes who the hell they are. I mean, except in very exceptional cases. And exceptional can be in either direction. They can play, if they play just exceptionally well or just exceptionally horribly. I have to tell one more story about the Queen Elizabeth, and then I'm done with this particular aspect. The one year I was in the Queen Elizabeth, Queen Elizabeth is one of those competitions, as are all of the five that we're talking about, where a contestant goes on stage and plays an entire program and is not stopped. And the program is either the whole program, or if it's selected from a program, it's selected in advance by the jury and the contestant knows what he or she is going to play. It's usually the smaller competitions where people are stopped, or they'll say, "Let's hear a little of the Bach," or something like that. In the big competitions, you know what you're going to play when you go on stage, and you're not stopped. So, but still, you have a time limit. So in theory, you can be stopped. There is a bell, but no one ever rings it. So we had a contestant who, from South America, who was playing the first piece he played. This was also the Queen Elizabeth, as it happens, where you have to play, there are six etudes in your program, and they choose three that you play. And this guy started with the Liszt F minor transcendental etude, which is a difficult, wonderful piece. And there's one place in the piece where it modulates into A minor, and then the later place in the exact same music, it modulates very beautifully into D flat major. And when he got to the second one, he unfortunately went back to A minor. So we all sort of shrugged our shoulders and said, well, we're going to hear, this is a 4-minute etude, we're going to hear the first 2 minutes of it again. The problem is that he spent his entire 55 minutes of the first round going around and around and around like a tape loop. Every time he got to that place, he went back to the beginning. And of course, every time he did it, he played worse. And he wasn't very good to start with, but by the time he was doing it for the 30th time, it was really pretty. And I was sitting next, that time they had me next to John Browning. They didn't make that error again. And John was having a horrible time not laughing. So he's trying desperately not to explode in laughter. So we're all like, you know, and you don't want to laugh at the poor guy. We're right underneath, I mean, we're right underneath the contestants. And so finally, when the guy did, it was the amount of time allotted, the president of the jury rang the bell and said, thank you very much. And so the guy looked all confused and this and that and the other, and he says, no, thank you, thank you. So he left. So he filed a complaint officially that he was mistreated by the competition because he alone, of all the competitors, had been stopped. So there you go, I mean, for what it's worth.
You know, this is not a competition story, but it is a story. I heard Georgi Shandor play Beethoven 111, and he got to the recap and forgot where he was and went back to the exposition, so we got to hear the development twice and most of the exposition twice.
Well.
And this reminds me of this kind of story.
Yes, except that this was much more than twice, but also well, wasn't Georgi Shandor, yeah. Anyway, so.
You wonder if in a situation like that you should out the rules at least enough to stop the person, because obviously they're...
What probably the wisest thing somewhere to do with 20/20 hindsight would have been to stop him way before, stop him the third time around and say, perhaps you should go on to another piece and let him play his repertoire. But it's hard to do that.
But that would also violate the rules,
well,
theoretically.
They would violate our agreement. The rules allow the president to stop a contestant anytime they feel fit to. But we had agreed in plenum, the whole jury together, that we would stop no one. We would let people play their whole programs. And we agreed that this becomes a big issue. Competitions have a certain amount of time in rounds, which of course becomes, you know, you have a lot of people playing, and there's fairness issues. And so if anybody gets to play a lot more than anybody else, there's issues, it's not fair. People are looking for any reason to explain why they didn't win and someone else did. And one of the reasons given is sometimes they got to play more. So somebody has to take the responsibility. So you start right off the bat, you say, we're going to pick what they play and try to fit within the time as best we can. But if they go over, they go over. We're not going to stop them. If they go over, you know, we've made the decision and we're going to live by that. That was the premise.
But the question is how far over?
Yeah.
Because it's one thing if they're supposed to play 55 minutes and they do 62.
It's another thing if they do
85.
Sure.
Right.
And that never happened. These are really dead end situations. There are always terrible problems, this fairness issue. For instance, in the Queen Elizabeth, but it could have been other competitions. But in the Queen Elizabeth, everybody played their whole classical sonata as part of the second round. And we had four contestants 1 year whose classical sonata was the Hammerklavier.
I knew you were going to say that.
Yeah, and which is long, which is 44, 45 minutes long usually. And so there was some talk, well, let's have them only play part of it. And they said, no, it's unfair, but that means that they're going to have to play very much less of the rest of their program. And I remember myself, even though I was the youngest juror and pretty much kept my mouth shut, said, look, if they've picked the Hammerklavier, they want to play it. So if we say, well, we can only, they have much less time to play their other repertoire, then they know that. They know, as opposed to someone who's playing the Les Adieux, which is 16 minutes long. So they've got 28 more minutes to play around with than the rest of their repertoire. So.
But now you bring up a question. In a free-form competition, you'll have one person put together a program that is moderate stuff, maybe moderate difficulty, moderate length pieces, a number of them. And then you have somebody else come along, and they program Hammer, Clavier, and Petrushka.
Mm-hmm. Both very difficult.
How do you judge in a situation like that? What criteria can you use to judge when you have one person playing two blockbuster virtuoso pieces, musical though they may be, and another one playing a bunch of different pieces, a wider variety.
Playing Schubert impromptus in a Haydn sonata. Well, I mean, in theory, this is one of the reasons why competitions have obligatory pieces, to have some way to judge on the same thing. But in theory, as a juror, you're supposed to judge the performance on its own merits and not be overly impressed either positively by the difficulty of the piece or negatively by the simplicity. But that's in theory only. And especially this is the case when you come, many, many competitions, every competition on the, well, no, everyone but Leeds on the, no, Cliburn no longer has any requirements. You can play anything you want. Mm. But most competitions, and three
Cliburn
of the five,
used to be very,
very
strict.
Very strict. Yeah. Three of the five competitions still that he has here, and still most competitions, require the performers to play etudes. Usually at least a Chopin etude and a Liszt etude or something like that. Not as drastic as Queen Elizabeth, where it's six etudes, but still etudes. Warsaw, you have to play three Chopin etudes, for instance. And there it really becomes a difficulty because there are, within the realm of etudes, there are etudes which are much more difficult than others. And someone who comes out and plays a dynamite fauffalet is simply going to get, from me at least as a juror, a hell of a lot more attention than someone who comes out and plays a very pretty paysage or something like that. I picked the most difficult and the easiest, but you see what I'm saying. I mean.
But you see, that's where the issue of programming, somebody who maybe is more comfortable with classical repertoire, with perhaps not the most difficult pieces, but that doesn't necessarily speak to their ability, it's just what they want to present in the competition, are at a disadvantage compared to somebody who's going to trot out, you know, things like Farfalle and the Hammerklavier.
But it's also true that different competitions, at least traditionally, and this goes back now to my era, not as opposed to today's era. I was growing up in the 70s, and I did my competitions all in the 70s, starting when I was 18 and then into my mid-20s. And basically from 70 to 77 would be my international competition career. And in that era, different competitions had very well-established reputations as to what kind of performer they were looking for. Leeds was looking for the kind of person who played Mozart and Schubert, whereas Queen Elizabeth and Cliburn were looking for big virtuoso pianists. Moscow and Warsaw are different because Moscow has a strong, you have to play a lot of Russian music, and Warsaw's all Chopin, so it's in a different category entirely. And Warsaw forces you to play some of the difficult etudes. If you look at the list of etudes, there's one from the sort of, you have to pick one from column A.
You can't pick any.
No, you pick one from column A, one from column B, and one from column C. Okay. And so they make sure that all the ones from column A are like 10-1 and 10-2. You know, I mean, this is piano talk now. But they've done it in such a way that you can't really avoid the issue. But in most competitions, you can. There's even another bigger point, Joe, that how do you judge pieces that you simply hate or don't like? I mean, you know, somebody comes and plays a program of pieces that you love, and then I say, oh gosh, I'm looking forward to hearing this program. And now, of course, if they play it badly, then it's especially painful. But let's say you have two people who play well, and one is playing a program of pieces you really like, and the other is playing a program of pieces you really don't like.
Hey, give me an example of pieces you really don't like.
Rachmaninoff's Second Piano Sonata. Rachmaninoff Corelli
Variations. I'm on that page too, by the way.
Rachmaninoff Corelli Variations. Tchaikovsky Piano Sonata, but nobody ever plays that, so that's not even fair. But okay, there's other pieces too. But still,
if you're a good juror, you can judge a piece you hate based on the performance.
You're not supposed to, as a juror, be influenced by that. Now, whether that how
probably not realistic, but at least that's the goal.
Not entirely. I mean, right. But that is the goal.
Now you bring up the issue. I remember at the 1979 Maryland competition in the finals that one of the contestants who had plenty of large romantic slam bang concerti like Rothery and Tchaikovsky, et cetera, decided he was going to make a statement by playing Schumann against competitors playing Rothery and Prokofiev II. And he thought he had a chance to get top prize. Of course, he ended up getting third. And the question is that fair? I mean, assuming, let's say, in my opinion, having heard the finals that year, his Schumann was way better than the person who played Rock 3, and yet he got third, not second.
And Schumann is probably more difficult than Rock 3.
It depends in certain ways,
how you measure difficulty. But
this brings up the issue of, do you have to trot out the humongous, bangy Russian blockbuster?
Well, I can. my success, the competitions I won, I was playing Chopin E minor, which is not considered one of the blockbusters. The competition I didn't win, the Cliburn, I played Tchaikovsky concerto. And I played Tchaikovsky on purpose because I thought at the Cliburn you need to play something like Tchaikovsky. Of course, I don't play it as well as I play the Chopin E minor.
What did Stephen play that year?
Boy, that's a good answer. I don't know. Of course, Lexo played Rachmaninoff. Stephen?
Oh, Lexo, I would have thought would have done Prokofiev second.
That's right. He played Prokofiev second.
Okay.
I'm wondering
what
you know
Stephen
what?
Played.
I don't remember.
Because Stephen was also not the kind of pianist who would play.
No. We had to play two concertos, and the other one was Mozart. So, I mean, Mozart A major I played, and he played Mozart. But no, I don't see him playing. Not Chopin. I don't know what he played.
We're talking about Stephen de Groot, by the way.
Stephen de Groot, who was the first prize winner that year. And that's going to be an interesting thing to talk about, is how people win prizes. There's different ways that people come out, and there's lots of different sorts of competition scenarios where people win. And Stephen, I think, a wonderful pianist and a wonderful guy who died very young of AIDS, actually, very tragically, nevertheless would fall into one of the categories of surprise winner, let's just call it. I think he was viewed as a dark horse. I think he was.
But the Cliburn has had a long history of surprise winners and an even longer history of winners who have gone nowhere, essentially.
Yeah, we should talk about that.
If you want to look at the history of competitions, which is my big interest, is what happens to the people who win, or conversely, what happens to the people who don't win? Because there's one obvious example that we'll touch on a little bit later, of somebody who had a much bigger career not winning the competition than the person who did.
Yeah.
But having said that, why is it that something like Warsaw has churned out one major career after the other, and Cliburn, for my money, has never churned out a major career? No winner of the Cliburn has ever had a top drawer piano career.
Well,
you can't count Ratulupu.
Ratulupu,
because Ratulupu won Cliburn in 66, and basically his career didn't start until he won Leeds in 69.
Correct.
That is where his career took off.
Sure. But
if you look at the rest of the list, I could read you the list, I could do it from memory, and half the pianists on the list you've never heard of.
And it's also true that in a lot of cases in the Cliburn, for instance, in 1974, 1973, the first prize winner was Vladimir Viardot, who has not gone on to a big career. But the second prize winner was Christian Zacharias, who has gone on to a very big international career as a pianist and as a conductor. And there are other instances of the Cliburn sometimes where people who didn't win first prize ended up making big. I mean, that's sort of the luck. Some of that is the luck of the draw. But there are the Cliburn. There are reasons, I think, why in some cases some people have won the Cliburn. Ralph Vodopek won the first one. It has to be said, I know this not because I was just a little boy. I was in Fort Worth at the time. We lived there when Lupu won. And I actually went to the competition because my teacher, Mr. Uninsky, was just completely blown away by Lupu. But I know for a fact that Van Cliburn, who was not on the jury, but was the force behind the competition, the reason why the competition was in Fort Worth, and he was still young. This was 1969. Van Cliburn was only 35 years old himself then. Van very much did not want Ratulupu to win. I don't know exactly what the reason was. And he did everything he could to influence jurors to vote for someone else, to vote for someone who's actually gone on to quite a nice career, as it happens, Rudolf Buchbinder, who was fifth.
He was fifth, that's
yes,
right.
Yes, second was Barry Snyder.
Right.
But fifth was Buchbinder, and Buchbinder was very much...
Now, Barry Snyder did not go on to much of a career
at all,
but he, as a teacher...
A teacher, sure, yeah. He went on to become a major teacher. But Buchbinder still is a very active pianist in Europe, very active, an Austrian pianist. But Van absolutely did not like Lupu. And I think one of the reasons is that they really didn't do anything for Lupu. He went back to Russia or wherever he was living, And when he won Leeds and it exploded. So, but you're right. He was the then Christina Ortiz.
That was 69.
69, and then Yathen of Yardot.
And then
Stephen
De
Groot.
André Michel Schub. Who became mostly a teacher and chamber musician.
Who already was.
Sigali, whose career went nowhere.
And poor guy,
he's passed away, and so has Sultanov, who won in 89.
And then there was the French
But 89 was, I was there so in
so
89.
And so was I, as a guest.
And 89 didn't produce anybody. I mean, that whole year, all the finalists.
Benedetto Lupo. Benedetto Lupo has gone on to a very nice career.
But not around here and not a major career.
No, but a nice career. Yeah. A nice career. Compared to most of the Cliburn winners, he's had a nice career. Benedetto Lupo, I would count as a nice career.
And after that, it's not even worth discussing anymore because most of the people, maybe Olga Kern is the one who has gone on most inexplicably to a fairly decent-sized career.
Well, I can't speak on that. I won't comment on current pianists. But I will say this, and this, I think, brings up a really, really, yeah, of course, they're not my, there's a really sort of very interesting major concern, interest is, I was at Juilliard in the 1970s. Now, you hear me, I was just rattling off the names of these winners of competitions. Anybody in the corridors of Juilliard or Curtis or Peabody, or the Paris Conservatory, or the Royal Academy of Music in London, or God knows the Moscow Conservatory, if you've gone down the halls and started asking people at random who were the latest winners of any of these five competitions, and several others, Busoni, Geneva, other ones, they could immediately have answered you. Everybody, from the biggest, best, most promising talents to the lowest, if you did it today, no one could. The kids themselves. So, I mean, something really basic, big, has happened to the role of competitions, and which is something, I guess, that we will address. I mean, it's easy to say, well, there's so many of them now, they've inflated themselves to death. But the fact is that, yes, there are tremendous numbers of them now, but still the big ones are still the same big ones.
But I think the problem is that big ones are feeding into a pool that's already oversaturated.
Yeah, I think there's a different.
And part of the problem is that the old timers, who you would think that normal, the attrition of time, might open up spaces, doesn't seem to happen because they don't seem to go away.
Yeah.
I mean, there are certain people, and I'll try not to name names here, who probably should retire, but are continuing to just churn along, and not making space for younger, worthwhile artists. That's certainly part of the
He's
problem.
Referring to me, of course.
As a young, worthwhile artist.
Right. Actually. No, as the other one. But I was my own view of this is different, or at least I think there's some truth in it, of course. But I think also is that if we look at the competitions of the 50s, 60s, and 70s, if we look at the music world of the 50s, 60s, and 70s, look at the violinists and pianists, and those are the two primary instruments that have competitions. All the biggest names were contest winners. You know, even Michelangelo, if you go even earlier, Gilels, but Pellini and Argerich and Vladimir Ashkenazy and for that matter, Christian Zimmermann or Mitsuko Cheater or Garrick Olsen or the violin would be the same. All of these people won competitions because it was considered a necessary step. You had to have that first prize. It was kind of a necessary pedigree for it. Don't think that Pellini or Argerich, Pellini in particular would be a good example, or Ashkenazy for goodness sake, were less proteges, less well known than the people today. But who would imagine Kiesin entering a competition? Who would imagine Volodos, or who would imagine Anne-Sophie Mutter or Mi Dori or Sarah Chang or I could go on, you know, or Yuzhou Wang. These people don't enter competitions anymore.
Well, they didn't. I mean,
no, and that's
for whatever.
No, but so the reason is another story.
I mean, it's an interesting thing.
But that to me is the reason why competitions aren't important anymore, or not on this level.
Because the best people don't enter them. Yeah.
Because the best people don't enter them. Because it's not that Yuzhou Wang is a better pianist than Martha Argerich was, but Martha Argerich had to win the first prize in the competition to make a career because it was considered to be necessary. Whereas for Yuzhou Wang, it's not considered necessary. So the business has changed, and the business's attitude towards competitions has changed. And I feel like that is for the big competitions. The big competitions in my day was, if you won, it was a if and only if, like one of those logic things. It was, if you want to have a big career, you have to win a big competition. And if you win a big competition, you will have a big career. Which, of course, the second part was never the case. We can go back, that goes, Adam Harasiewicz won first prize in Warsaw, and he never made a big career. So that was never the case. Perhaps we should start listening to some music now.
Well, why not? Yes. I mean, I have this whole pile of CDs here. And one of the things I wanted to do, because one of my particular interests in studying this subject is those who didn't win and went on to careers, and those who should have gone on to careers because of their ability or whatever particular circumstance in a competition. The most obvious example, but I'll save it for later, is 1980 Warsaw, where the winner is a very good pianist, and we'll play a little something of him. But the guy who didn't get into the finals had one of the biggest careers in the world.
Yeah, for 15 years.
That was Pogorelich.
Pogorelich for 10 or 15 years.
And because of a scandal, because Argerich was so irritated that he wasn't voted into the finals and quit the jury. And I think we'll deal with that a little bit later. I want to go back in history a little bit. Let's start off hearing maybe the earliest person we have here. And it's your CD, as a matter of fact, if I can find it. Oh. Well, this is...
That's not so early.
This is Yuninsky, who was the winner in 1932 of Warsaw.
He's not on that record, though. Unfortunately, he's not on that record.
Oh, no, you're right. It's not Yuninsky. No, Harasiewicz, I wanted.
Harasiewicz is 55.
55.
Okay. No. So this is the year that he was first prize, and Vladimir Ashkenazy was second prize. Vladimir Ashkenazy was only 17 years old, or 18 maybe, but still, I mean, Vladimir Ashkenazy is certainly a household name, and went on to win the next year. He went on Brussels, actually.
By the way, I would say that of all the pianists who did competitions in that era, he has the best track record.
Yeah.
Second in Warsaw.
First in Brussels.
First in Brussels, and tied for first in Tchaikovsky in 1962.
Yeah.
It doesn't get much better than that.
He has a good track record, for good reason, too.
Well, yeah.
And the reason there is background, probably Harasiewicz won, too, because Poland, in 1953, as you all probably remember, Josef Stalin died. And even though Poland remained a colony of Russians, very much under their thing, under their political and cultural control, nevertheless, as I was told by Poles, that if Ashkenazy had been God himself, he was not going to win the 1955 Warsaw competition. It was going to be a Pole. And sure enough, it was. So I think that has something. Whereas the one before, when Bela Davidovich tied with Halina Czerny-Stefanska, that was still when Stalin alive. They didn't have any control then at all. So that was. But anyway, let's listen to some.
Incidentally, one of the co-winners of 49 is, as far as I can tell, the furthest back winner that's still alive, which is Bela Davidovich at the age of 92.
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
All right, so this is Mr. Harasiewicz, who actually made a lot of recordings. He recorded complete Chopin, I think. This is his third impromptu, G-flat impromptu, opus 51.
From the competition. From the competition.
Thank you.
surprised there's no applause, actually.
Yeah, well, they probably edited it out.
Probably edited it out.
Well, you can't say that if they were going to say that a Pole was going to win that competition, at least they picked a good one.
Oh, they picked a very good one. And it's interesting also, a point, why didn't Harashevich make a career? Of course, Ashkenazi's. And I don't really know the answer. I mean, in some cases, we're going to hear one very shortly, Ginsberg coming right up, I guess next. Some cases, of course, politics came in. There were great pianists who, from behind the Iron Curtain, who won competitions, who disappeared because they were considered a flight risk. There's one example, I don't think we have one, but I can give, because there was a pianist named Yevgeny Mogilevsky, whose son is also a pianist. Mogilevsky. Mogilevsky, right. He won.
I have plenty of his.
Yes, that's true. Oh, he made a lot of records. But I have
a live performance of his I want to play,
okay.
Actually.
Okay. Anyway, so then I'll save him for that. But this is an example of someone who made almost no career because he won Warsaw. He won Brussels in '64.
Right.
He was supposed to come to Warsaw in '70, and they wouldn't let him out because he was considered a flight risk and a problem. And then so he never played in the West until much, much later when he actually was left. He defected.
Right.
But he was a flight risk as it happened. But
and it was a proven
flight. But there was a 20-year period there where he was not playing. I mean, and this was true of a lot of, this was especially back in the 50s, I mean, where just about nobody came out. Richter, I guess, was the first really to come out. So
Gilels, actually.
Was after Richter, though, wasn't he?
Oh, yes, that's right. No, Gilels was 55. Gilels came in 55, Richter came in.
Okay.
And Gilels was telling everybody, wait till you hear Richter. Richter would say, wait till you hear Berman.
Well, they're different kinds of pianists, all of them. Right.
But in the case of Ginsberg, who got fourth in 1927 in the first Warsaw, the only problem in playing anything by Ginsberg is picking it, because everything Ginsberg recorded is absolutely phenomenal piano playing. So I thought I would play something that he also transcribed. And I'm sure all you pianophiles in the audience know this recording, but if you don't, it's an example of his phenomenal piano playing and his phenomenal
transcribing
ability. It's the Largo al Factotum from Barber of Seville, his own transcription of it.
You know when this was recorded?
Let's see if they say. Thank you.
I'm going to throw in now a little bit of a devil's advocate thing, because I think it's significant. Yes, the guy was Jewish. He was lived under the time of Stalin. I mean, I barely know his name. I mean, I'm just a pianist. Joe is the one who knows piano players. But the reason why someone like Harashevich wins first prize and this guy wins fourth prize, and I think that there is a point to be made here, which is that this guy, the kind of people who are on juries, are not only not necessarily very appreciative of this kind of very inventive, very extravagant, let's say, piano playing, very giftedly, extravagantly gifted, but they're threatened by it. You know, there are members of jury.
That surely sounds like they're not doing their job.
Well, no, but the problem is that most members of jury are teachers. And you know, you're playing pieces already in transcriptions. They typically look down on transcriptions, or it's a very special kind of piano playing. It doesn't fit into any sort of the kind of, you know, the sort of canon of things you're supposed to do or not do. It's all this very strange wrist stuff, which is really remarkable. But I don't think that a lot of the kind of people who are on juries really entirely approve or appreciate. This was 51. He was in the competition much before that. But
And I'm sure this didn't exist. He didn't write this transcription that early.
No, that early, surely not. But still, the kind of piano playing he is not going to have changed. You can see this very scintillating, very personal kind of playing.
But if you heard his Chopin Etudes, Opus 25, which he recorded.
But I bet you that
among the best ever recorded.
I believe you, but I bet you that Lev Oborin, who won first prize, is a sort of a more solid pianist, and whatever that means. And this is just talking about. In competitions, you're judged. There are certain kinds of competitors. You have one we're going to be listening to, I think. Who's sort of a much later version. I don't think that he's anywhere near as good a pianist as Ginsberg, but very much in the same manner is Cyprian Katsaris, who also plays a tremendous amount of transcriptions. Well, he was with me in Brussels when I was there, and I basically won, but didn't because well, that's Gilels. But and he was ninth.
Right. And that was a big scandal because a lot of people thought he should have won.
Oh, no. Nope. That's entirely invented by him after the fact.
That's what he said in his liner notes.
Nobody thought he should have won, and nobody it was a scandal. He played horribly in the finals. He played Rachmaninoff III.
Horribly in the finals.
He played Rachmaninoff III in the finals. He did not play well in the finals.
And here's all the evidence.
You have the Rachmaninoff III right there?
Yes, it is.
Well, I don't think it's good. Except he does play that one passage better than anybody, the double note ones. What was the solo piece?
Chopin minor polonaise.
That's right. I remember that too. He was with us in the Chapelle. He was very angry about things. His teacher was on the jury, which is a very double-bladed thing, having teachers on jury. Monique de la Duchellerie was on the jury.
Oh, she was on the jury.
She was on the jury, yes, sir.
I have a little side story about her, but yeah. Finish your
point. No, the point here is that Cyprien has great qualities, but exactly not the kind of qualities that go over well in competitions. And as far as I know, he never won any competition. I mean, he was never a top winner in any competition, as far as I know. Was he?
Who, Cyprian?
Yeah,
I don't think so.
I don't think so. And this is
that was
not
probably the best he ever did in a competition.
Yeah, ninth. And that's not a that's just certain kinds of people do. When one of the very very completely different kind of pianist, but for completely other reasons. Like David Golub never won a competition, never won a high prize. Mm-hmm. And he's one of the best pianists. I mean, if you got pianists around, we'd all start with God, what an unbelievably great pianist he was. There's certain kinds of people who don't do well in competitions for a variety of reasons. In the case of David, it had to do with it was hard to identify his personality. In the case of Cyprien, he annoyed people.
He had too much personality.
Yeah, he's messing around. He's showing off. He was the most, listen, I mean, and this is takes one to know one, you might say. He was the biggest show off I have ever met. I mean, this is, don't forget, here we are, the 12 of us locked up in the Chapelle. The only people we can see are the cook and the conductor who came in twice for each of us to run through our concertos. And he spent the whole time on the, we each had a piano in our room, but there were two big Steinway concert grands in the public room. He spent almost all of his time in the public room showing tricks that he could do with the piano. And he had more tricks, these double note tricks and things like that that he would do.
Nothing has changed, by the way.
I haven't seen him.
Because I know him pretty well.
I haven't seen him in 30 years. Well, I saw him once in 30 years. I mean, but anyway, no, I mean, we were really impressed.
Just to show what we're talking about here, I'm just going to play the first two or three minutes of the Escher Minor Polonaise.
Okay.
You will certainly hear things that you have never heard before and probably don't want to.
This is live from the finals of the competition.
From the finals of the competition.
That I was in and that he was in.
we've made our point.
Okay, but if I were on, this would be an interesting case. If I were on the jury, well, you know.
Well, I would have two reactions. Damn, those are good octaves. Yeah. And it's so unmusical.
Yeah, well, or it's so much not a Polonaise, yeah. And there's
so much not a Polonaise.
And there's also remarkable amounts of schmutz, of sort of casual schmutz. He's so into the things he kind of, and of course, anyway, but there's extraordinary piano playing in a certain kind of way. Well, and the Rathieu was that way too. But anyway, this is, and Cyprian.
But nothing has changed. He plays exactly like this now.
That's just. If he has octaves like that, he's got to be 70 years old now.
He's born in 51, so
okay.
He's
68.
And he actually still does have that kind of mechanism. It's quite amazing. By the way, I mentioned about Monique de la Brucherolie, a little side thing. A friend of mine was asked by whatever that piano magazine, the British one, I don't remember the name of it. The one...
IDQ?
Yeah, thank you. That helps. Yes, International Piano Quarterly, was asked to do a survey of which was the best Chopin fourth ballade. I mean, let's start with the fact that this is one of the most ridiculous things to do to try to compare every existing recording
it's a
of
piece
it.
That every great pianist has played, and it's one of the hardest, greatest pieces there is.
Well, yes, all true, and was recorded over 300 times at that time. So my friend, who's the pianist Dmitry Rachmanov, dutifully did his diligence and listened to every single recording he could find, which was virtually all of them. I think there were two or three that simply could not be found. They were very obscure. She won.
Okay.
He considered her, Monique de la Brucherolie, to have the best fourth ballade, recorded the best fourth ballade of all 300 of them. Interesting, huh?
But the point, this goes back, this is kind of a competition kind of thing. If there had been a jury of nine, I wonder what the consensus. One of the things, too, this is just at a break in the music now. Another, I remember one of the things that people wonder about in competitions is why sometimes do the same people do well, over, and I don't mean win necessarily, but do well in competitions. And, of course, part of it is because they perhaps play the best. But also it's because there's a lot to be gained. If you're a familiar face, don't forget the jurors are hearing a whole lot of people. They're being bombarded. It's long days of listening to people. Familiar faces that have done well in other things that they know have a certain advantage, or, I mean, in some cases, disadvantage if they've done badly. I think it's very, very difficult to come as a complete newcomer on the scene and to do well in a competition that nobody knows you. It happens. It has happened. It happens in a certain scenario, which is this the time to talk about the different scenarios in competitions? Yeah, sure.
Well, we can start in on that.
One of the scenarios, I was talking the last couple of days with some colleagues of mine, we talk about what is the pros and cons of having, some competitions have very large juries. Warsaw and Brussels, or the Brussels in the finals has 19, and Warsaw has like 15 for the whole competition. And then I was just now on the jury of a competition in California, which is a big competition in terms of the prize, but for kids, for under 18. There were three of us on the jury. So what are the pros and cons of big and small juries? And one of the obviously the reason for a big jury is that you get a wide variety of opinions, you get a great consensus, it avoids one person from having too much influence, you get somebody, you know, not having, but one of the big difficulties of a great big jury is that people very often vote, they sort of think, well, you know, I don't need to vote for this one's gonna win anyway, but I like this young man or I like this young woman and I wanna help them, so I'm gonna vote for them. And it turns out that they end up winning. This happened to me when competitions that I've been in, where you get these complete dark horses coming up and winning just because with such a large jury, you get enough people giving them good votes and nobody actually gave them first prize. It has happened in competitions that people win first prize without ever having been anybody's choice for first prize, just because nobody really voted badly for them. And this happens more often on great big juries than small ones. Of course, the big difficulty of small juries is that, first thing, if you have a very powerful personality, they can simply run right over the other two people, let's say, or the other three people. And the other thing, of course, is that if you have a situation where everybody is, if you have three totally different opinions, then it can become really just a madhouse. I've judged a lot of competitions with three people because I judge competitions at Juilliard regularly. Juilliard, in its wisdom, now has outsiders come in and judge the competitions. I'm not a faculty member at Juilliard, and there's always three people. And usually it's extremely easy. There's no discussion, it just happens right away. But sometimes it's just hell because, you know, we all have a different idea, and who's going to win then? I mean, you know, who's going to win that idea?
Do you think jurors should just vote without discussion?
This, of course, is another huge point. Just to give some background, I would say that in the old days of competitions, especially before the 1960s anyway, and maybe even before the 1970s, there was always discussions. The jury got together and they voted, but they discussed, and they voted and they discussed. And of course, the big difficulty there is either outward collusion, in other words, where somebody really absolutely says, you vote the way that I want you to, or else. You have powerful people or people who have something over their heads. Or you get weaker people, just by personality weak, and they say, you know, they'd say that they had given Jeffrey Swann a 23, and then they hear all these other people say, well, we're giving him an 18. So they say, 18, and they change their vote. And this kind of thing, of course, happens.
Well, how often does collusion and this kind of backroom politics end up screwing up
competitions? I don't think it happens. I think that's different things happen today. I think that used to happen. Okay, we're going to get to me eventually, but my first competition was the Warsaw competition in 1970. I was 18 years old. I'd never been to Europe. I'd never done a competition. So I was really a dark horse. And I was, right from the start, a huge favorite with the critics and with the audience. At the end of the second round, the critics, the panel of 12 critics in Warsaw, gave their opinion as to who were going to be the top three prize winners. And I was the only person who was on everybody's list, 12 out of 12. And I didn't make the finals. So there was a big scandal about I not making the finals. And they ended up publishing just my votes. Nobody else's votes, just my votes got published. And there were a couple of very interesting things. Now, first thing, in modern, this is competition still judged the old-fashioned way, which is 0 to 25. Hmm. And
by the way, Warsaw now is 0 to 10.
Okay, with 0 to 25 in those days. And a lot of competitions now have yes, no, maybe in the first rounds, and then in the last, all other, there's lots of varieties now. Brussels is 0 to 100 still. And of course it's tricky because people have very different ideas of what these numbers mean or how they use them. But in any case, it's supposed to average all out. And they don't throw out the highest and the lowest in Warsaw. They do now maybe, but they didn't when I was there. This was not done when I was there. So first thing,
because I want to mention something about the last Chopin competition.
Okay, two very interesting things came about when they showed my vote. One is that I was the only person in the entire competition with a 25, which is the top possible vote, and that was from Tatiana Nikolaevna in the second round. And I was also the only person in the entire competition who got a 0. And that was also for the second round, and that was from Guido Agosti, an Italian judge. And there was a person in the competition who played one mazurka, had a very bad memory lapse, and withdrew, didn't play anything else in the second round. And he gave that person an 11, but he gave me a 0. And when asked about it, he was asked about it by the press, and he said, at least that girl showed humility. Swann is arrogant. Now, he had never met me before, but he decided I was arrogant. So this little, and that was that. The other thing that was interesting about when they published the votes is that it just, one of these strange things, there were 6 polls on the jury, and they all gave me 13.7. Now, that's just a strange chance, isn't it? Just like an amazing coincidence that 6 out of 6 gave me 13.7. How did that happen?
You know, I like the 0.7 part, 0.7 actually.
0.7 part, yes.
How did they come up with that?
Anyway, that's what I got. We don't know what anybody else's votes were like, because they only published my votes in that competition.
Oh.
And they, because of the scandal. Later on, they published everybody's votes.
Yeah, because now they do publish everybody's votes, and an interesting little scandal was at the last Warsaw, which was won by the Korean Sung Jun Cho. Almost everybody gave him either a 9 or a 10. I think it's now 0 to 10. Except Philippe Entremont, who gave him a 0. Mm-hmm. But it got inexplicable, but he won anyway.
But it got thrown out, probably. I think they throw
well,
high and low.
Well, I don't know if they're doing throwing out low and high, but in any regardless, he did get first prize.
I mean, you do get there are the only thing you can do about jurors like that is not invite them. These people who take who get these big animosities, but it is so. I don't think that this kind of collusion 13.7 exists anymore in the post Berlin Wall world. I don't think that what you do get, there's two kinds of major, not so much collusion, but what we call the dishonesty, I think that really do still run in competitions. One is on a very personal level. You don't like people's teachers. You don't like the schools they go to, but especially the teachers. The rivalries are usually not the students, you don't know the students, but the contestants, or you know them as contestants. But you get back, you say, I hate this contestant because he studies with whomever. And so, you also know that you have only one vote, and they'll throw it out if it's too low. So you have a friend on the jury, and the two of you vote low for these people. You haven't gotten in the back room and made a deal, but you both know this. This happens. This happens.
Still.
It still happens, yeah. What happens even more, though, and which is almost impossible to happen, is there is this group of people that I referred to when I was in Busoni, who the International Piano Mafia, the people who go to competitions all over the world. And for these people, going to competitions is their meat and drink. They love it. It pays well. They stay in nice hotels. You have dinners every night or parties every night. You get the royal treatment. Also, it's great recruiting if you're a teacher. To be on the jury people want to study with someone who was on the jury of the Queen Elizabeth competition or Warsaw competition. So there's big attractions to it for you.
And on the other hand, the Cliburn for this last one, which is in 2017,
no one had ever been there before,
made a point of throwing out everybody who was on the previous juries and completely revamping it.
That was
actually a scandal in and of itself.
There was another scandal, right? Yeah. But what ends up happening with these people who are professional jurors, and that's the best way to call them, is that their interest is to get invited. That's what they do for a living. Now, what do you do if you're in a situation, a work situation, when you want to get invited back? Well, you try to please your employers. So what these people do is they come to the competition with a very fine instinct, nose for which way the wind is blowing, what kind of person that the people want to have win. And they typically are really good at going in that direction. Well, that's not dishonest, it's not collusion, it's not, but it does, it's not, it's at the same time, it's not fair really exactly. And I think this was very, very much something that would happen if we compare two Cliburns. I mean, the Cliburn in most of its history has picked very, especially in its recent history, has typically picked very sort of safe and they've been accused of being sort of bland winners in some cases. But and this was especially true, whether it's fair or not is another story, of poor José Figali in 1985. So in 1989, there was this extremely strong feeling, which I had heard before the competition started, this time we're going to go after charisma. This time we're not going to get some academic bore. We're going to get some young kid with lots of charisma who has... And so they picked...
A 19-year-old.
18-year-old. I think he was 18.
He was 19,
okay. Sultanov, but the age perspective, he was 19 going on 12. I mean, he was a young 19 who talked about what his favorite thing in the world were big cars and karate. And, the poor boy died at 32 of complications from health problems that were his own. I mean, I don't want to go into it, but he wasn't ready to win the competition. He's talented and a good pianist and all that, but it wasn't the best thing for him as it happened. But I think that a lot of the immaterial, I don't know the circumstances, but my gut feeling at the time was the jury came there, and if I picked up on it, they picked up on it. The competition wanted somebody with, a real firebrand, and so they picked a firebrand. And I do think that I don't think that we have the kind of collusion they had in the communist era. In the communist era, there was a very simple thing that happened over and over again. And the Cliburn is a good indicator of this. And so is Brussels. The Soviets would not come the next, if they didn't win first prize, they would not come to the next competition. They would make it absolutely crystal clear. And they had created a situation where everybody felt that the best violinists and the best pianists came from the Soviet Union. So if you didn't have the Russians there, your competition wasn't really first class. So for instance, at the first Cliburn, Ralph Vodopek won over Nikolai Petrov. So with the second Cliburn, when Radulupu won, there were no Russians. Then Vladimir Viardot won, so then there were Russians the next time too. You know, Lexo Tarazzi. But then, as soon as the Russian didn't win, this was true in now Russians won every time in Brussels, except, for instance, they didn't win in 1950. Now, Fleischer, they didn't come. 52, the Russians weren't coming because Stalin was still alive. Mm-hmm. But in 1960, the Russians did come and they didn't win in Brussels. One of those years. Anyway, that maybe they did. Who won in 60 in Brussels? Now, Malcolm Frager. Malcolm Frager, but there are no Russians. The Russians didn't come, obviously. I don't know why they didn't come, but they didn't come. Because look at the next time they came and they won first and second.
Second, right.
And then they won again and they won again. And then they won again. Look at this fireman.
Well, but the truth is that these names are people who are extremely fine pianists.
Oh, many of them are great pianists.
In reality, I mean, they're...
Sure. But there were still... Yes, they're great pianists, but at the same time, I remember being so angry at the time as an American in Brussels, but also another... And I didn't do that. I mean, I did Montreal, which I was third. I did Vienna de Monte and Lisbon, where I was third. And I won the competition at La Scala. But I remember audiences all the time, they would be incredibly, like as soon as a Soviet pianist was going to play, the hall would be full. You know, the expectations were really high. That used to, as an American, that really would annoy me.
Let's play one of those Russian pianists that were worthwhile, which is Yevgeny Mogilevsky, actually. He won in 64, Brussels. I have a recording of his from 74, Tokyo. And what I want to play, because I, in listening to this, I really thought this was astoundingly beautiful playing. It's two Scriabin preludes from Opus 37.
I wish we had something from the competition, but still. It's...
No, just as a little side thing, what piece does the first of these two preludes, which, by the way, he plays them backwards, it's number 3 and then number 2 of Opus 37. It'll be a little quiz after. What piece is the first of, in other words, number 3, remind you of?
Thank you.
everything sounds like
anybody
Wagner.
Else?
Well, the fourth Scriabin Sonata. The
that's,
first one,
that's what it sounds
like. It's completely, it's like one quote after another, yeah.
Exactly.
The same period. But, okay, anyway.
This guy is a very good musician.
Well, you know,
I really like his playing.
Yeah, he played well back in 64. In 1970, when my first competition in Warsaw, he was supposed to come, and at the last minute, the Soviets didn't let him out. And Garrick Olson realized, Garrick Olson, only, he knew he was going to win. And the one person he feared was
you.
No, later on, actually, that's true, because of the success I had with the audience. Ask him, he would tell you that. But before the competition started, it was Mogilevsky, because he'd won Brussels and had this reputation. And so every night when we had dinner together, we would have a glass of vodka and toast Mogilevsky, because he wasn't there. So that was the thing. No, I mean, I had one very interesting little tidbit about collusion. I had just arrived in Warsaw. And I was an 18-year-old kid, and I met Eugene Enjic, who went on to win fourth prize, whose teacher was Witold Maciuszynski, who was president of the jury. So he said, so what do you hope to get out of the competition? I said, well, I think I'm too young to win first, but I'd like to win fourth. No, I'd like to win third. He says, well, you're not going to win third, because first and fourth are reserved for Americans this year. Well, first was Garrick, and fourth was him, and they're both Americans. So maybe it was chance, but there you go.
Sounds collusive to me.
Yeah.
Since we're talking about controversy, and since it's 8:37,
let's do a poker.
I think it's time to look at the 1980 Warsaw Chopin competition, which was won by a wonderful Vietnamese pianist, Dong Thai Son. And what I think I want to play, hope I can find it, I don't know which track it is, because it's not listed. Okay, probably track four, is Foray First Barcarolle. We'll just do a little of it. Not the whole piece, because it's 4.5 minutes. Okay, so a little taste of Dong Thai Son, who's really lovely pianist and still plays really well. And
where does he live?
He lives in Montreal.
Okay.
I think he's teaching up there. Never developed a major career. The guy who got kicked out in the semifinals, though, which was Ivo Pogorelich.
For about 15 years, had an incredibly big career.
For 15 years until his wife passed away and
he kind of had a bit of a nervous breakdown.
Was arguably between the period of 1981 and 1995 playing some of the best concerts I had ever heard.
Well, I always hated his playing, but he's an incredibly great pianist.
Incredible pianist.
Yes.
Just for kicks, let's hear. This is from a concert in Warsaw
that
he was invited to right after the competition ended, when he got kicked out, and Martha Argerich resigned from the jury because she was really upset by this. Chopin Etude or Two. Thank you. You can love it or you can hate it, but it's
phenomenal. No. And that was not hateable. Nothing in that was hateable. One thing clear on his elimination was not because he was no one had ever heard of him, because he had already won Montreal competition at the time. I mean, he was something of a known quantity, and he was controversial for a lot of reasons. He wore leather suits and stuff like that. And anyway,
you know, I think we need to hear a little bit of this pianist named Jeffrey Swann.
This would
be a good idea.
Well, this is not from one of the competitions I won. This is from Cliburn when I was third.
It's from Cliburn where he got third. But I think a few minutes of the first movement of Schumann Fantasy, Opus 17, will give you some idea of why he did so well in so many competitions. Thank you.
don't think I've heard that since then, actually.
Jeffrey created the most difficult task I had to do today. He asked me to decide whether to play the opening movement up to the legend or the second movement in its entirety.
Second movement is
a very difficult decision because they're both pretty darn good.
Well, that was an interesting do you want to talk about that competition?
Well, we should give time for questions.
Okay, let's do questions. Okay.
Anybody have questions, comments, kvetching, whatever?
So one question that comes to mind, knowing many music lovers here in New York that occasionally tell me that they travel to hear the Cliburn, or they go from competition to competition as listeners, no, not as pianists. And I'm wondering, do you think that attending a piano competition will ever become the same phenomenon like somebody will travel to hear, somebody will travel to watch the US Open or Wimbledon or something of this sort? And do you think it's legitimate for a music lover to approach music and the discovery of young talents this way, through this mechanism of competition?
Why not just go to concerts?
Yeah, but there's, I guess, your point is well taken, of course, because the whole premise of a competition is artificial, because we started off the evening with Bartok's quotation that competitions are for horse races. However, I think the reasoning, people get excited by the whole competition thing, but you hear a lot of people that you otherwise don't hear, or they feel like they hear people, I heard him win, before she became famous. So there's something to be said for that. My personal feeling is I'm happy when anybody goes to hear music, classical music anyway, for whatever reason. So there's something to be said. So there's something to be said. And one thing, it's true that up until 1980, all the great performers of piano and violin were contest winners. And then there's been a long period without. But just recently, we have had one superstar who's a major contest winner, who won one of these five competitions, and that's Daniel Trifonov. He's the first one in a long, long time. He won Tel Aviv, which is a big competition, and then he won Moscow. So he's sort of an exception. But there are people who love the whole. I know people who definitely go from competition to competition. Right. And
the question is then, do they love really the music, or they love the competition
Do
element?
Do people love the music, or do they love dressing up? I mean, I don't know. I'm happy to see them. If they fill the house, they're happy.
Right. I guess that's the...
No, of course, look, the premise, one of the things that's the hardest to do, now I'm a teacher now, and I have students who do competitions. They don't do these competitions, but they do smaller competitions. And you have to make sure they understand that they don't play one bit less well because they didn't win, nor do they play one bit better because they did. That competitions are an experience in themselves and have practical advantages. It gives them a chance to play, a chance to master a program, a chance to make lots of contacts, which can be sometimes the most important part, the people you meet, the things like that. But at the same time, it doesn't necessarily reflect on your playing. You can't. There's no easy way to make to collate. I played this well, I got this result. I played this badly, I got that result. It just doesn't necessarily work that way. So you have to view it. They're events in themselves. They exist sort of in their own little vacuum. They don't have the same position in the music world they had 30, 40, 50 years ago. But they still are interesting to go to, and sometimes interesting to judge. I judged a competition 6 weeks ago, 2 months ago, in Southern California. It was just kids, and there was this 11-year-old boy who played the D-flat nocturne and Chopin Etude 10 number 1. He could barely reach an octave. I mean, it was just simply flabbergasting.
Oh, sure.
Just completely, entirely flabbergasting. So, whether he'll come up to be another Pogorelich or Pollini or whatever, I don't know. But, boy, he certainly was flabbergasting when we heard him.
But there is a point that has to be made for any of us that are in this world professionally, in whatever way we're in it. There's no difference between us going to a competition or going to a concert. We are going to be judging it.
Yeah.
Regardless.
Yeah.
When does a professional musician go to a concert and not and doesn't judge it, because with our knowledge we can't help but compare it to what we know and what we've heard previously and all that. So the question is, how often do you, you're a very high level pianist, Sandro, how often do you go to a concert and you turn off your judging mode?
Oh, this never happens.
Well, exactly. I go to...
I wish sometimes it happened.
I mean, Judy Sherman and I have had this this conversation about going to concerts and not being able to turn off the fact that we hear things wrong, whether it's out of tune or rhythmic issues or ensemble, whatever. And it, I don't know if it hinders your enjoyment or helps your enjoyment, but it's there.
Well, one of my points was also what really lures the attention of people in the music world, and also the music business gives so much importance nowadays to the world of competitions. And of course, sometimes it's right, I think it's legitimate, other times I personally don't think they deserve all this attention.
I could correct you there. I think that the business side of the music world pays less attention to less than they did, but yeah. Certainly the world of press. I think that it's just because it's very understandable. It's a format that everybody can, it's like going to Wimbledon or the US Open or something, has a very understandable format. It's easily sort of graspable as an experience and is packageable. As far as kids, I think there's a lot of reasons why kids do competitions. But one of the reasons that they do competitions, which is a pretty hard one to answer away, although they do far too many, is that when you're a young, if let's say that you're a 21-year-old and you want to become a neurosurgeon in some very specific field, and it's a very difficult goal. You have to pass all kinds of exams, and you have to be in a very small percentage of each group that you're in, but you know exactly what you have to do, and you do all these things to get to that point, or not. But for young musicians, the hardest thing is you say, what do I have to do to get concerts? What do I have to do to perform? What obviously everybody starts out wanting to perform. And you're looking for, what can I do to make progress? What can I do to get to this goal? And you know, competitions at least gives young people something to work for. Whether it's a good thing to work for or not is another story, but it gives them something to work for.
In this respect, do you feel that teachers today should also give the young musicians tools to make connections, to basically expose themselves in different ways,
yes,
in addition to competition?
Yeah, unfortunately.
But most teachers are not capable of that. They don't have the tools, the business tools,
or
they're not interested.
What teachers don't give is a long list. For instance, very few teachers. There have been some. Dorothy DeLay, famous violin teacher. They don't talk about how to prepare yourself for an audition, how to dress for an audition, what programs are appropriate for auditions that are not necessarily appropriate for competitions, and vice versa. What are the different kind of programs you need to have? Because it's very different between a setup where you're going to play for 10 minutes and a setup where you're going to play a whole program. All these things, very few teachers ever address this. And these are very concerns to everybody. They're even concerns to the lower end of the students. The students are definitely going to go into teaching because they need to do auditions to get into the schools, to programs. And they don't have a clue as to what kind of pieces to play or how to present yourself or and these are things that unfortunately teachers don't address. Among the many things that they don't address, but that's a very important one. And competitions is in that same category. And I do think that a lot of times kids do competitions, for the French expression, faute de mieux. There's nothing, they don't know what else to do, so enter another competition. And we have examples of people who play very well, who did very well, who entered 30, 40, 50, 60 competitions. I mean, I think, some people who've really, you could do it. Right now as we speak, for instance, tonight, there is a competition going on called the Top of the World Competition in Norway. There is the Great Tchaikovsky Competition going on. Very soon, the Paderewski Competition is not one of the biggest. I mean, there's constant, big ones, small ones, intermediate ones, all kinds of ones. So, and it's also an industry that creates itself. One of the things it creates in the industry itself, of course, is jurors. As I said, there are a lot of people out there who basically make a living judging competitions. Yeah.
Thank you.
We have. Yes, we do. It's going to make you work up those stairs again. I don't think I'd do that.
Thank you. First of all, thank you both for coming and doing this program. I actually wanted to follow up on something you said, although the reverse. I've served on juries where, on small juries, where the performers have been so terrible, we couldn't find a winner. Mm-hmm. And the last time I did that, we were thrown out. We were never brought back. It was the last time we ever did that that competition. So I comment on this because it's sort of the reverse of what you're talking about, where you have these professional jurors who sort of glean what they're supposed to say. And the main reason that people were so outraged was us, it was the teachers who were outraged. They were there, and they were appalled that we didn't pick anybody. Yeah. We picked one third prize winner only because she had some style, and she actually got it wrong because she didn't play the right pieces. Mm-hmm. And everybody else was terrible. Mm-hmm. And I'm curious if you've experienced things like that.
There's a lot of reasons why competitions don't give prizes. And very often people get angry. Now, there are some competitions. Buzzoni's
ridiculous because Buzzoni doesn't give first prize three out of four years.
But that's
and considering the level of the competition, it's ridiculous. Brings up a question: should a jury be required to give a first prize?
Well, you know, I noticed, for instance, the competition. I was reading the rules because my friend is on the jury at this Top of the World, and that one they're required by the rules to give every prize with no ties. Exactly.
Degina Backhauer does that.
Yeah, but there's the real basic consideration, right? What if nobody is worthy? You know, you do have a high, you have certain standards, and I run into this, strangely enough, in competitions at Juilliard. Because at Juilliard, the competition is not for some kind of absolute value, but rather it's to play with the orchestra. There's an orchestra concert already scheduled with the concerto, the required concerto on the list. And the best is going to play that concert. And we've judged competitions where the consensus was clearly among us that none of the kids was ready. None of the kids really was ready. But we're not given that option there. Whereas in the competition you're talking about, you obviously kind of felt that you had that option. But you get very angry teachers. One of the worst things in competitions are teachers and parents. I've only been slugged in my entire life once. Once. And this is a good story. This was also Queen Elizabeth. I have too many Queen Elizabeth stories. I was on the jury of the Queen Elizabeth, and there was a young pianist whom you may have run across at some point. He was not young anymore, but this was 1991. Igor Comments.
Oh, I remember that.
Igor
Comments
was very much
He got second in Maryland a couple of years.
He was
that.
Very much championed by a big Italian piano guy named Piero Attalino. Anyway, Comments was in the Brussels competition, and is very idiosyncratic, would be a nice way to put it, playing. And he was eliminated after the second round. He was actually almost didn't get into the second round. And as the jurors left the jury room after the announcement of the second round, I happened to be the first person to walk out of the door onto the street, because I was actually going to hold the door open for some other people. And as I walked out the door, somebody slugged me right in the face, and it was his mother, who just was going to slug the first juror she came across. And the thing that makes it particularly ironic is I think I was the only person on the jury who voted for young Mr. Comments. I kind of liked him, but I mean, kind of, but still, that's, you know, yeah, that was a bit, but I mean, a very, very beloved, a good friend of mine, a member of the faculty at Juilliard, after one of the Juilliard, usually when I judge those competitions, I get the hell out of there as fast as humanly possible. And if there was like one of those shoot exits where you can kind of go straight from your seat to the street, I would do so. But I was delayed, and I got cornered by the teacher after the competition, and he was ready, I've already given away something, the sex of the teacher, ready to murder me. Because how is it possible that his student didn't win? How? First thing I said, I had no idea who was. They don't tell us, and I don't want to know. And, you know, it was like, what are you supposed to answer in that? I mean, this is unanswerable. But your point is well taken. There have definitely, this is one of the side points of there being too many competitions. Competitions where nobody should win, and you're in a situation where you don't. This is not going to happen at the Queen Elizabeth competition or at Moscow.
Not at major competitions.
But it does happen. Yeah. And it happens. Juilliard is a great institution, but it happens when you have, like, you know, I remember I judged Bartok 2, and we had four people who played Bartok 2, which is in some ways the most difficult piano concerto, I guess. And all of them kind of could get through it, but nobody really was ready to play the piece. But we had to give it to
somebody.
What
year was that?
Like 3 years ago, 4 years ago. And we picked somebody, but it was you know, the right and sometimes the right result is not possible. But if you worry, you can't worry about angry teachers, because there's always going to be angry teachers, and angry contestants too. So.
Actually, teachers shouldn't be allowed either at competitions or in recording sessions.
Oh God, recording sessions! I can only imagine. Yeah. Yeah, but of course, but this is just caveat emptor to some extent. You're an employee of the company. I mean, as a judge, you always understand this, and this does go back to what I was saying before, that these judges who want this, what they do for a living, to get judged, they do what they think the people want them to do, you know, you take your job seriously and you vote your conscience. Sometimes that's going to mean that you're not going to get invited back. That's just the way it goes.
Do we have any more time?
You want to add any concluding?
Any other questions before we conclude? We answered all your questions so effectively.
So effectively.
Yes. Okay. Well, thank you, Jeffrey, and thank you, Joe, once again. We want you back again next season sometime and figure out a topic which will work.
Sure, we can come up with something.
I think you can come up with something. The last one you
time
did
limits
was
are the problem, not topics.
This one is just as good, if not better. I want to thank you all for coming. This is the last meeting of the season. We're planning to start in September and maybe October. It all depends. We're still putting the programs together for next season. So thanks for coming, and enjoy the summer. See you in September or October.
Thank you.
Thank you.